Indeed, welcome to this webinar. I will start this presentation by quickly going through some trends because the world is changing. And then I will continue with talking about value. And basically, a good understanding of value is necessary to define meaningful innovations, which will then be the next subject. And the last part of this webinar is about designing ecosystems, where you can basically design innovations with multiple parties and make sure that you have business models that bring value to different people. As mentioned, first some trends. Basically, Philips in general has some general trends that you're probably all familiar with from the corporate slides. Healthcare is becoming unsustainable due to the costs and the social impact that we have. So we will have to do something about that. Another trend is that emissions of using our products are actually much higher than the ones during the production of these products. So there's also a nice challenge over there. A third one is related to the resources that we have, the waste we create, and the fact that resources are becoming very scarce. And we will have to basically rethink how we are going to do innovation in this area. There are also some things that are a little bit going beyond the Philips scope. Some innovations are really looking into system transformations. If you think about subjects like the smart grid, e-mobility, or even healthcare, where we are also involved in, these require new ecosystems with public and private partnerships working together to basically find new solutions. And there's another thing going on, and that is that people basically want to contribute to creating a better world. And they don't just want to do that as a charity in the weekend or after office hours, but also during their business days. And this has long been a niche concept, but it is no longer. So there's really a number of people getting concerned about how can we combine business with creating a better world. And we need that, because the world's in crisis. You can basically look at different crises. They're all there, and you can pick the one that you can start working on. There's enough to do. And we cannot just do that by philanthropy. So I don't mind, or I'm actually basically happy that our Christmas presents have been donated to charity goals last December, but I don't believe that is enough to solve the crisis that we are currently facing. So we need to do something. And if we don't do something on the negative side, then citizens will basically blame us and they will shout it around on social media and they will definitely damage our brand. On the other hand, if we do it well, they can also work for us in making our brand more stronger. So, all in all, what's basically happening is a big paradigm shift. And we need to see what the next transformation will be. If you look at it, then we come from an industrial area and we as Philips are still having good business in that respect. This is a picture that was created by Philips Design about rethinking value in a changing landscape. And basically the last column is describing the transformational economy that we are heading for at this point in time. And in that economy, it is not just about producing stuff, but by really contributing meaningfully. And that's for people. The mindset of people is that they would like to do something meaningful, but it's also for business that need to contribute to some societal goals and do that in business networks instead of traditional value chains. And that is quite a shift. And if you would like to do that, then basically the context of our business is really changing. Our life used to be fairly easy. We were just producing stuff, sell it to a customer, and we could get nice money in return. So, stable business, very comfortable. But it's no longer the case that life is as simple as that. There is this whole context of other business parties being involved, social media having an impact. We need to collaborate with competition once in a while to get new standards implemented. There's public organizations. And we need to take care of the planet and society at the same time. And then the question is, basically, how can we find good solutions that create value for users, for the organizations that are involved, and for society at large? And basically, that is about a business, new business ecosystem. So then we basically touch upon the word value, and that is where I did my most of my studies in university, about being really trying to understand what value is all about. And traditionally, we look at mostly at the economical perspective, but if you look at other social sciences such as psychology, sociology, and ecology, there's nice new insights that we can basically combine to understand value a lot better. And we would like to do that not just as a business, but looking into what does value mean for users, because they are the ones that are ultimately needing to be happy with our products. But we also need to understand that for the bigger ecosystem that we are part of, and ultimately for society as well. So this framework is basically combining these different insights, and I'll show you in the next slides how we can basically use this framework to define value. So the first part of it is economics. And I'm not going to talk a lot about that, because I think there's been said enough about economics so far. But if you look at the economical point of view, then you can translate value as value for money for the user, the profit for the organization, stability for the ecosystem, and wealth for society. So that's basically value from an economical perspective. If you look at psychological view, then you can get quite some additional nice understandings. One of them, I know there's a lot, but I will mention just two. One of them is from positive psychology, and that is about understanding what is it that people value, and they define a pleasant life as basically the lowest level, where you have a good living, but the highest level is a meaningful life, where you really contribute to something larger, something beyond your own needs. Another interesting view from psychology is the motivational values. There's basically, you can look at this circle from different perspectives, and there are opposites in it. So some people are really driven by getting achievement or power, while others are really driven by contributing to something beyond. They want to really take care of the planet, and they really want to contribute to something larger. And there's also another axis that is about being able or being open to change, or just not really wanting to adapt. So some people are really wanting to change and adapt themselves. So if you translate those type of views, again, in the value framework, then you can define that as a happiness on the user level, being able to define the core values for the organization, and looking for shared drivers at the ecosystem, and then the well-being on psychological, on the societal level. So these are basically notions of value that are quite different from the economical one. Then the next piece of information would be on sociology. And sociologists look at the world a little bit differently, because they connect relations to relations, and they see things in combination with each other. So the first thing that you can then get is that things can have a symbolical value that is way beyond the material value or the economic value of things. And an example of that is the value of honor that is related to the medals in the Olympic Games. So they, of course, have a value in itself, being bronze, silver, or gold, but the value actually is much bigger than that. Another notion is the sentimental value, and that is basically related to the origin of where products or services come from. And an example of that is these plastic bands that are from a party in Ibiza in 2009. So they are, on the one hand, simple, cheap plastic bands, but if you've been to this party at that point in time and you met your boyfriend there, then definitely they have a different value. Another example from sociology view is the absolute and transcendental value. That is value that is for products that are not for sale, so you can't buy them, like the crown jewels of the UK. And the value is then basically much more related to the fear of loss. So you can't buy them, there's no economic value as such related to it. But the fear of loss is very high in these type of products. So the sociological view basically adds another dimension to our value framework. And then the user is basically also seen in context to other people. So a sense of belonging is then the value that is related to that. For organizations, that is the social responsibility in their bigger network. And in the ecosystem, it is about reciprocity. And that's not necessarily reciprocity on economic level, but also how can you really sustain relations, basically. And on the societal level, it's about living a meaningful life and making this contribution. Then the last one I will not go into very deeply either, because it's also reasonably familiar for most people. That's the ecological view, that is has to do with the eco-footprint that we have as a user, or eco-effectiveness, or cradle-to-cradle type of solutions on organizational level. Sustainability of the ecosystem in a bigger context, and livability of society on the highest level. So these are the basically the four perspectives that we used to create this overall framework on how can we look at value. And then if you zoom in basically again, then it's about how can we use this framework to define meaningful innovations. And basically, we then look at meaningful innovations as innovations or value propositions that offer an opportunity to create an experience on user level where the user is really having a pleasurable experience, an opportunity for organizations to keep doing well, because that's, of course, what they need to be sustainable in the long run, and on ecosystem level, to keep doing good. So there, the notion of adding to something higher is implemented. And on top level, on societal level, we would like to create this transformation that we need to solve our problems, or the challenges, to say it nicer, that were mentioned in the introduction. So basically, the meaningful innovations are then value propositions that combine those four aspects into one value proposition. And to give it to give an example, this is the Ambient Experience Hospital. I think most of you have come across. And if you look at this example, and you look at the model and use it to plot where this value proposition basically adds value, then the first part is that the user, of course, in this case, is the patient. The ecosystem, in this case, is Philips as the, sorry, the organization is Philips as the producer of this product. But in the ecosystem, you also have the hospital, the contractor, the contracting party, the insurance companies. So there's different people involved in the ecosystem as a whole. And, of course, society at the top level. And then you can look into where does this innovation basically add value. And this is probably to too small to read in detail, but to give some examples, an innovation like this adds value to also to, for example, the doctors that can have a better image, better picture quality, and therefore have a better diagnosis on patients that have been scanned in this system because they were more lying more still during the scan. It also adds value to the parents of, for example, children that had this scan because they have a less traumatized kid back at home after the scan, after the hospitalization. On societal level, it also adds value because if you look at the integral healthcare costs that are lower in such system, then of course we benefit there as well. So we can use basically this model to look into the value of innovations, but what then also strikes is that we have been able to define the value of innovations very much in the past in economic and functional view by looking at the revenues that we could generate and basically distracting there the material and the labor cost, and then we could calculate the tangible value in plain hard euros, although you can discuss if the euro is still hard, but it's, compared to the other values it probably is. But we now need a much more holistic view. That is also related to looking into things like quality of life, like safety, well-being, and reputation. And we don't have a spreadsheet where we can add these things simply up. So intangible value is becoming much more important in these type of innovations. And we are basically hampered by not having the tools yet to do that simply. On the other hand, we may not be able to calculate it, but intuitively we very well know which innovation is bringing more intangible value than the other one. So although it's a nice subject for further research, and I'm confident that I will have in the coming years an interesting job in university, but we still can use at a pragmatic level already this notion. So that basically was the first tool that I would like to introduce to you, this value framework, as a way to map the value of a new value proposition, assess it, and also use it to creatively think of where can we basically add more value. So what can we do to enhance our value proposition? Then the next part, and the last part, is about designing ecosystems. And if you talk about these valuable innovations or meaningful innovations, then you basically need ecosystems because nobody has all the information. If you would like to achieve a transformation in society or really get a breakthrough in healthcare or in energy use or any of the other many things mentioned before, you will need different parties to collaborate. And basically, then you, if you do it consciously or not, is basically the question. But you will do it anyway. To give you an example, I use a project that we're doing at the university on dementia, and dementia is becoming a bigger problem. We are lucky to become older, and we have these aging populations. But the downside of that is that the number of people with dementia is growing quite fast. Moreover, it's not just the people with dementia, but also the people that are taking care of dementing persons are suffering from physical and emotional problems or fatigue. And in fact, 98% of the people taking care of dementing persons suffer to that extent that they really feel it as a problem, and they also end up in the care system. So there's a real concern on how can we handle this. And one of the problems that are related to dementia are the fact that people have disturbed the sleep-wake rhythm. So they wander during the night, they have nightly unrest, and during the day they are sleepy. It's probably connected, the two, but it's happening. And basically, that's why the people caring for dementing persons get so distressed, because they can't sleep at night. They're continuously looking for their partner and see if he's still there. And if he gets up just to go to the toilet, then they're already scared that he will wander around. So they don't get a lot of sleep. In institutionalized care, there has been this solution that has been proven very useful, where basically these people are helped by a boost of light in the morning to reset their circadian rhythm. And it has been effective in this institutionalized care, but of course that is when a person is already institutionalized. And we would like to solve, or at least reduce, the stress at the caregivers already when people are still living at home. So we're looking for a redesign of this solution to be used in a home situation. And we did an initial value assessment on where could we actually contribute to that. And then we started to really understand how is this process of dementia basically going, and we made patient journeys for basically three personas, typical persons with dementia, and we used that to understand what the process is that they go through. And here's three lines plotted. I will not go into a lot of detail, but there's three lines plotted. One, the red line is from a person that is basically very much refusing to accept the diagnosis, so he doesn't want to collaborate with his doctors in the treatment. The blue line is for a person that is very well accepting his diagnosis and kind of ideal patient, if you look at it from the perspective of the people that care for him. And the green line is for a person, a lady, a widow in this case, that is acting a little bit strange, but her environment doesn't want to tell her because she's widowed and she's already has so much difficulty. So let's be nice to her and not tell her. So she's not aware of the problem, but she ends up in the care system anyhow in the end. So that's basically, by plotting these patient journeys, we basically wanted to understand what's happening and who are the stakeholders that these people get across. And if you plot that, then you get a picture like this, where this patient is the lonely person in the middle. And he is basically confronted with all kinds of stakeholders directly in his environment, like his family and caregivers and home care providers, but also more institutionalized care, like nursing homes and people giving ambulant care. And there's also, like, on a remoter site, lots of institutions that are interested in the costs involved, like insurance companies or government institutions. And there's people doing research on dementia and solutions for dementia. So this initial map we used to understand how could a business model really look. And therefore, we want to know who could be direct customers or users of such a system, so we can highlight those. That can be the patient himself, but it can also be the places where he's frequently visiting, like the ambulant care facilities. We look at it from the perspective of who are the indirect beneficiaries, because they are beneficiary, maybe they are willing to pay somewhere in our system, or maybe not, but at least it's good to know that they are beneficiary. And then we have the potential payers. This is typical in many solutions. These are usually only a few, unfortunately. So we will be looking into who could actually really financially support this system. And the last part that we can highlight is who will be disadvantaged by such a solution. And in this case, if we can really treat the nightly unrest by light, then of course these people will need much less medication for sleeping pills or other medication. So that is at least disadvantaged there. Then the next step is when we understand who are basically the people involved, is that we look for scenarios for value flows. And the first thing is the most obvious: how are the goods and services being distributed? So in this case, we will provide a lighting system to maybe the patient or these ambulance care facilities where the patient is frequently visiting. So that's pretty straightforward. And then we want to know how the financial flows are going to run. And in this case, it could be very well that the facilities are willing to invest in this system. So they pay a price, and basically we're in the old-fashioned business model then of shifting a box to the client and getting paid, and then business is done. But if you look at the system for the patient, then it's not so likely that that will happen, because the chances are that this system are reasonably costly. And moreover, patients are in the Netherlands not really known or not used to basically paying a lot for their healthcare treatments. So they will expect at least a partial reimbursement, but probably even full reimbursement from their insurance companies. And we can also lower the threshold for them to be interested by adding another role to the system, the role of the entrepreneur, where we can basically look into leasing constructions, which make it much more affordable for many patients if they only have to pay a monthly fee instead of a one-off big lump sum. So that's how we also use this model to basically add new roles during the process of figuring out how we can make this system run. Information is the next value flow, and the value flows for information are in many cases increasingly important because in this case, for example, insurance companies want to know if this is really having an effect in the long run, so monitoring information is important, but there's also information related to how much is the system really being used that we can also see as important value for the producer of the system. And then there's the last bit, the intangible value, and here are things like the reputation of the care facilities can be very important. So if the patient association is ranking one of the care facilities higher because they have a good quality of service for their patients, then that is very important to them, especially now when there is more competition in the healthcare system. So if you add that all up, then it becomes a kind of incomprehensible spaghetti. But still, it's useful to look at it and see if, for example, if you take this nursing home as an example, if there is balance in the value that he has to deliver to the system and what he gets out of it. So if we zoom in, then we see a number of arrows coming to this nursing home and a number of arrows going out, which he has to provide to the system. And here we have this problem, of course, that we cannot add these up in euros and then see if there's a positive balance. But here our intuition is very useful in seeing if this would be something that is a positive balance or not. And we can basically check this for all the important stakeholders in the map and make sure that there's reciprocity in the total ecosystem, and make sure that all the ones that we need are kind of seeing this as a valuable innovation. And so therefore the plot, the graph that we have will probably change once in a while because we have new information or we need to accommodate for a certain stakeholder to make sure that he gets positive balance out of it as well. And then the last part of the discussion is about selecting the roles for implementation. And so far, We have not been mentioning companies as a name. We have a lighting supplier, manufacturer, we have installers, we have roles that are basically independent of who is going to do it. And then you can have a discussion like if we, for example, look at Philips, what role do we want to play? Do we want to be the product manufacturer only and delivering the lighting system? Or do we see that we should also include the service? And then also, basically, that could be for a number of reasons, but one reason could be that that will make it easier to enter the market. Or we could even go as far as say we would like to provide a total solution. So we will also provide like this lease construction to our customers. So we will take the entrepreneurial role as well. And then basically this can be done for the other parties in the system as well. And basically that is the second tool that I would like to present to you, this value flow modeling, to understand how the ecosystem could work. And that of course gives then input to how should we design the system, because the differences in business models, the difference in needs from the different stakeholders can impact the value proposition. So we defined basically a value proposition for ourselves, how we can help as consultants in navigating to meaningful innovation, which we call InnoSense. And it basically is made out of five steps, where the first step is seeing if in a new opportunity or in an existing opportunity where the value gaps are. So there we use the value framework that I presented in the first half. And with those value gaps, we can look into a value proposition, define it, and then identify stakeholders in the second step. And these stakeholders we can then invite to, for example, brainstorm sessions or workshops where we can enrich the value proposition, again, using the value framework from the first part. And once we have this value proposition in a way that we feel that the most important values are addressed, we can then create value scenarios using the flows in the model, as I showed it the last bit. And basically then we're ready for implementation. So that is basically what we have defined. And as Mike mentioned in the beginning, this is the book. And if you want to know a lot about details, then you can find it there. But we're also open for questions at this point. So, thank you.